I was a below average kid in my mid school. Average grades, no participation in sports and co-curriculars. But something really significant happened in class 8. You remember those really sweet teachers randomly asking you, what do you want to do in life? I was in 8th standard, and when I was asked that question, I said, ma'am, I want to join the Indian Army. It took me 4 years of hard work, sacrifice, and convincing my parents, since I belong to a civilian background. But I did keep my promise. And 4 years later, I made it into the National Defense Academy in 2015. My dream came true. I was a person who used to believe in the blueprint of life. While I was under training at NDA, I had planned everything. When I'm gonna start dating someone, when I'm gonna buy my first bike, Royal Enfield, because there's a lot of craze for Royal Enfields in the army. And then we got to know that 7th pay was coming. So I was like, chuck Royal Enfield, I'm gonna get a Harley. Life seemed to be sorted. I'm from Ranchi. It's the state capital of Jharkhand. People back in Ranchi knew me since I was the only cadet to get into that batch. I wasn't Ronit there. I was 37385 Mike 135 Cadet Ranjan, and that number was my identity. As Army cadets, we were trained how important numbers were, be it the coordinates of the map or the number of front rolls required to cover the entire hallway. Life was tough, but really satisfying. And each and every day, I reached closer and closer to my goal of getting stars on my shoulder and that black uniform. 28th of January, 2017. I woke up to a really fine day. My cross-country practice was on point. My athletics event was coming up. I was clearing all of my PT tests, and things were in sync just the way I had planned. But life is unpredictable. That afternoon, I met an accident during training, and the next 45 days were spent in the military hospital. Now, getting injured and ending up in the MH was a normal thing for cadets. We get treated, we heal, and we get back to training. And nobody has to know about it. There's no point. So I thought this was just another injury because I had been hospitalized once in my first semester as well. So I didn't pay much heed to it. But a month passed by, and I received no update regarding my medical condition up till March, when I was shown my MRI scan reports and X-ray reports, which said, diffuse disc bulge in L2, L3, L4, L5 lower back, indenting the thecal sac. Never did I imagine that it would become my last day of training. I was told that I was unfit to continue in the Indian Army. A part of me died that day, and there was a one-week phase wherein I contemplated of committing suicide, and I planned how to do it. I wrote down different ways to kill myself in that hospital building, and I set a date. But 2 days before the D-Day, I was lying on my bed and I was going through my family's photographs when it suddenly hit me that I was being a hypocrite. I was being a hypocrite because all my life I had been working on myself, training myself to fight battles. And there was a big battle right in front of me. And instead of fighting it, I was planning an escape. So I said to myself, this is not me. That even though a part of me died the day my career was over, there were other parts in me that were still alive. That even if I don't get up for myself, I'll get up for my family, my friends, and people who count on me. And sometimes people ask me, Ronit, what's the bravest thing you have done? And I say, the bravest thing I have ever done was to live when I really wanted to die. And I wish you never face something like this, because there are, in these kind of moments, if you tell yourself one good reason to live, 10 different reasons will pop out and tell you why you shouldn't. And at the end, all that matters is the choice you make. I made a choice that I will live. So this talk is not about falling down. We all have faced tragedies and hurdles in life. And for those of you who haven't yet, you will. That's life. You see, there are moments in life when it hits you hard. So hard it shatters you to the core. And I'm sorry you had to go through that. I'm sorry that this had to happen to you. But it's all a perspective. A wise man once said, you don't drown by falling in the water. You drown by staying there. So get up. Paddle your arms. Trust yourself and get the hell out of there, because sometimes it doesn't really matter if the glass is half empty or half full. Be grateful that at least you have a glass. So this talk is about how to protect yourself while you're falling down and to bounce right back up. Talking about protection, I have been a very protective kid since I was 5 or 6. And by being protective, I don't mean that you don't take risks. In fact, if you really wish to protect yourself, you'll take more risks because there's growth available there. The more you push yourself, the more growth will take place if you seek for it. Look at this wonderful smile. That's my parents. This picture was taken on 26 Feb 2017, their wedding anniversary, and also the year that changed my life. But this picture means so much to me because it reminds me how my parents have smiled their way through every obstacle, every upset in their lives. And I have learned that if you can smile while facing adversity, you will emerge as a winner. My dad has never let us down. He has always done everything under his capacity and beyond just to make sure that our family smiles at the end of the day. I remember in 2005, we were going through some serious cash crunch to an extent that we couldn't afford the cable TV bills. I was in third standard then, and we had an art and craft project to submit for evaluation. Now, the project required fancy art material, acrylic color, glass, straws, fur, beads, and whatnot. But we were so broke that we couldn't afford it. I was dejected, and I started throwing tantrums and fits of anger, and I blamed my parents for not letting me buy those items. What my father did that day brings tears to my eyes when I think about it today. He cut out a picture of a tortoise from one of his activity books, separated its legs, attached it to the chart paper, and sewed those legs into the body in a way that the legs could move freely. And if you pulled the string, the tortoise seemed to be walking in the air. And he asked me to submit that as my project. The next day I went to school and all of my friends submitted things like clay models, stuffed dolls, and treasure boxes, etc. And when I was asked for mine, I simply said that I didn't make anything, just because I was too embarrassed to show that little tortoise. When I look back at that episode, I feel so angry and disappointed at my younger self. And I regret not acknowledging my parents' effort of going out of his way to save his son's project. Today, I would do anything to get that tortoise back, but it's gone. So friends, please appreciate what you have while you have it, be it things or people, because you lose them at some point. My dad has always been my role model. He has taught me that you should never hurt someone. And I think I have got my protective instincts from him. And if he was watching this talk right now, I would just say that, I'm sorry if I have ever hurt you. I love you. Now my mother. Moms are the people who would do anything under the sun just to keep us happy, even at the cost of her happiness without ever complaining about it. My mom is the pillar that holds together not only our family, but our extended family as well, taking the hits most of the time. There's a big lesson of sacrifice and strength right there. And I would personally request each and one of you to go back and tell your mother that you appreciate what she does for you and thank her for that. You might come across the most beautiful smile you'll ever see. Now, coming back to my father, his teachings and values made me what we call in the army lingua as OG. I was an OG kid who did the right thing all the time. And I carried that to the academy where I became an OG cadet. And I was proud of it. I still am. But that makes life difficult for you in the army, because you keep getting screwed here and there on behalf of your course mates, and sometimes you'd wonder if being morally upright and taking care and taking responsibility for your action is even worth it. But our academy prayer had a very powerful statement which said, always choose the harder right over the easier wrong. And that statement has stuck with me since that day. In life, when I'm faced with tricky situations, I ask myself, what is the right thing to do? No matter how difficult or exhausting it might be, and even though I end up nowhere, I'm still satisfied that I respected myself. After the entire NDA episode, I went into depression. My immune system got vulnerable. I gained 25 kgs, and I didn't have much to speak. But I had to move forward, right? So I joined Christ University, and first year was tough. Being the older guy of the department, I found it very difficult to adjust. But people around me were very supportive, and I settled eventually. College life made me realize that it's important to stay in the present. I learned that we should not allow our emotions to control us. We are emotional, but we got to begin to discipline our emotions. If you don't discipline and contain your emotions, they will use you. I have seen life, I have seen death. I don't know what's going to happen to me tomorrow, or will I even see it tomorrow? That's not in my hands. But what I do have is the present, because it's right here. So please stay here. It's all right to go back to the past at times. I understand it's a resourceful place and we should pick up the learnings from it. I also understand that it's important to visualize and wonder about your future in order to advance towards it. But don't dwell on it. Come back to the present and ask yourself what can be done with the available tools and attitude to make this perfect and work towards it. Today, when I go to perform at events in and around Bangalore, I'm faced with the common question that, Ronit, given an option, will you go back? And I say no. Because I would not be who I am right now if it wasn't for that accident. So stay in the present. It was at that phase when I found an emotional release through the form of poetry. I remember the first poem that I wrote was called The Mighty Mustang, which encapsulated my experiences from the army. The very next day, there was an open mic in Bangalore, and I thought to give it a go. To my surprise, I received a standing ovation after my performance. And after the event, many people walked up to me and said that you should share your story on different platforms. I took that seriously, and I started writing and performing poetry extensively. During the process, I realized that the more I shared my story, the lighter it made me feel. So I made a short-term goal that I'm going to get a book published, and I started working towards it. Focus and discipline are two very important things while you're working on something. A winner's heart isn't like a light switch. It doesn't go on and off when someone's watching. It's constant. So make a routine and stick to it. And every time you feel like procrastinating, ask yourself why you started at the first place. Remind yourself of the hardship that you've endured and use that as a fuel to your fire. There's a famous saying in the army, people don't move ahead unless they get a hockey stick up their asses. So use your pain, use your passion, use your aggression as that hockey stick and march on. Do whatever you can with what you have, because what you have is plenty. There's nothing more powerful than a human being with purpose. In October 2018, my debut book, The Mighty Mustang, went live on all major e-commerce channels. And the response has been amazing. I received texts and emails from readers all across the country who shared their story with me and tell me how my story inspired them to move forward in life. And I think it's a small part that I am playing to make a difference. So I would request you that whatever you achieve in life, whatever resources that you build, whatever learnings that you experience, share it, help those in need, and contribute. Today, I do everything under my capacity to give back. I write about things that matter. I talk about things that matter. I'm a peer educator, a social worker. I spread awareness. I possess 3 organ donor cards. I'm here right in front of you trying to give what I have learned through my experience. And that makes me happy. So try touching people's heart. Try bringing happiness into their lives. It will give you immense fulfillment. And if you screw up during the process, just apologize, forgive, and move on. And most importantly, love. That's me with my course mates. There's no point of all of the other things that I talked about if there's no love. Love for your country, love for your family, love for your work, love for the society, love for yourself. Just give yourself an opportunity to love. And you might come across several heartbreaks, but I say love yourself so much that you never run out of it. And you should know why I gave this talk. I think that all of us are broken somewhere and screwed by life. And it's okay. There's nothing wrong about it, and there's nothing to be ashamed of. So my point is that if I am screwed, you are screwed, why don't we join our hands together and get screwed together? I'm not saying that things will get easier, but you will have a moral support that you're not alone in this battle, and that, my dear friends, is a good feeling. So go protect yourself. And during the process, everyone around you, you are important. And before I go, I'll share a poem that took me 2 years to write because I left it unfinished while I was on my hospital bed, and I finished it last year while working on my book. Trigger warning, this poem includes graphical imageries of suicidal thoughts and attempts, which might be difficult for some audience. It's called, Is It Time? Once I wanted to die, and I'll tell you how. I could get bitten by a snake, it'll take around 30 to 60 minutes, or I could slit my wrist and finish it off in 15. Talking about poison, cyanide is the quickest, 7 minutes. But that'll be painful, I wonder. Or hey, I could take sleeping pills and never wake up again. That'll be peaceful, isn't it? 5 minutes if I hang myself, 3 minutes if I drown, 2 minutes if I touch a live wire and electrocute myself out. Nah, I need it to be quick. I could probably just jump off a tall building or pull the trigger placed on my head. Done and dusted in a second. Well, I thought of all this and honestly wanted to try them so much. But I guess it's not the time. Or is it? Well, I thought of it again and again and again and actually came up with an answer. I could use those 30 to 60 minutes pumping my arms at the gym. I could use those 15 minutes going through my family's photograph, help a friend, stand up for a good cause, support a stranger, empathize, love, hope. I want to listen to my favorite song for those 5 minutes or look into someone's eyes for three. I want to kiss someone for those 2 minutes and then dance like crazy on my feet. And I don't want anything quick because I want to live life bit by bit. Thank you so much. Jai Hind.